Good morning. Welcome to worship with West Bloomfield United Methodist Church. We're so glad that you're joining us here on this YouTube broadcast so that you can worship with us this morning from the safety and comfort of your homes. We hope that you'll enjoy this worship service, that it will be a time of blessing and a time of growth for you as you join together. We also invite you to just take a moment and remember all of those who are not necessarily gathered together in person, but in spirit as we watch this video of our worship service together. Immediately following the service, everyone will be invited to join us on Zoom so that we can have a time of prayer together and a time of fellowship. If for any reason you don't know how to get connected to that Zoom and need information about that, I invite you to email me at pastor@westbloomfieldumc.org, and we'll be able to share that information with you. If not for this broadcast, then for next week as well. At this time, I had wanted to also just make sure to share a couple of announcements and thank yous with everybody. First of all, a thank you to all of those who helped to make sandwiches and deliver sandwiches down to Noah in Detroit this week. We made several sandwiches to help feed the hungry people down in Detroit, and we give you thanks for being a part of that ministry of compassion and care. Also, thanks to everybody that took a part of their Saturday morning to come over to the church and parsonage to help out with the trustees' workday and get things ready for the winter and clean things up around here. Thank you so much for your time and effort on that as well. A couple of other announcements and things that are coming up. Want to make sure that you know that we are, in fact, gathering scarves and hats and mittens for Baldwin and for the clients of Baldwin. And so if you would like to participate in that ministry this year, we would love for your donations to come in. We'll have a box in the narthex of the church. If you come in during office hours, we can let you in. Or if you'd just like to contact me or our secretary, Joanna, call the church, let us know that you'd like to bring those by, and we'll arrange a time to receive those from you as well. At this time, I'd also like to introduce to you Kara Mulligan, the chair of our finance committee, as she's going to share some information with you from the finance committee this morning.
Good morning. I'm Kara Mulligan, finance chair here at the church, and I'm here today to let you know we're going to start our annual fall stewardship campaign. The finance committee is tasked with being good stewards of the funds that the members contribute to the church, and each fall we put together a budget planning for the upcoming year. We are fortunate to have some hardworking trustees that keep our operating costs to a minimum. But because our operating costs are funded 100% by the members, it's important for us to have an idea of what the giving is expected for the coming year. We ask you take time this fall to look at your personal budgets, think about the ministry the church provides, how your family is impacted, and how you can continue to financially contribute towards the West Bloomfield United Methodist Church. We know this year has been anything but normal and challenging to say the least. But as I reflect back on the church during this time period, I have a positive personal note in that we shared the marriage of Patrick and Alyssa this summer. It was a crazy time to plan a wedding and to say the least, and we were probably on plan D or E by the time the event arrived. But I have to say, in the end, everything was perfect. During all the planning, it was important for Patrick and Alyssa to have a ceremony in a church building. And it happens to be the church building where Patrick was baptized and confirmed and grew up with a loving and supportive church family. We are extremely fortunate to have these ties to West Bloomfield. We worked with Pastor Monica to facilitate the ceremony and do so in a meaningful but safe way during the pandemic. Brent and Mary Webster's and others lended helping hands and encouragement to make the ceremony run smoothly. It's times like this that make you feel very blessed to have a church family you can count on. So take some time this fall to think about what West Bloomfield Methodist means to you and help us plan for the upcoming year. In the next few weeks, you'll receive correspondences and hear some different messages about how the church finances and how we have dealt with the ministry during this COVID year. So thank you for your continued commitment.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in thy offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Pick up today with our sermon series on Jesus' Sermon on the Mount from the Gospel of Matthew. This morning, our first scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 19 through 24, where Jesus said, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." And then a second reading this morning from 1 Timothy chapter 6, beginning with verse 6. "But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs." May God add a blessing to the reading of this holy word. Let us pray in preparation for our message. Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks for this day, for your word in our lives, for the community of saints that surrounds us. We pray, God, that as we listen to your word this day, you would enable us to listen and to hear your word for us personally, so that we might know the which way you call us, to grow in our faith, to grow in our discipleship, to grow in our love for you and our neighbor. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen. You know, there are so many things that to keep everyone safe you can't do right now. You know what I miss this time of year? Yes. The rummage sales. I always have so much fun at rummage sales and can't do that this year, but you never know what you're going to find. I actually brought with me a couple of things that I picked up at one time to show you. I was so excited. For instance, for about 10 cents, I picked up these xenon light bulb replacements. I don't have any lamps that these work in, but it was such a good deal, I just couldn't pass it up. Had to have it. Had to have it. And then, oh, I found this great thing, especially as we're getting towards the end of the year. I found a brand new copy of How the Grinch Stole Christmas in Latin. If anybody wants a copy of this for the year, let me know. Let me know. And one of my all-time favorites, this actually was a white elephant gift exchange. I found an orange fire hydrant, and sitting right next to it, thank goodness, was a pair of sunglasses. This has a prominent spot on my dresser in my bedroom now because everybody needs an orange fire hydrant, right? This is good stuff, right? Good stuff. So all this stuff, white elephant, rummage sales, garage sales, auctions, here's the thing about all of this stuff, right? Everything in my house, I've been going through, I've been putting things away to stake to a rummage sale when I'm able to. Everything you own, everything you buy this year that you have, it's all one day going to end up in somebody's rummage sale, somebody's white elephant room, sold for pennies on the dollar. But then, you know, you might say, what about my really valuable stuff, right? The really good stuff, my china, my silver, that solid oak dresser I've got, those aren't going in a rummage sale. And, you know, that's probably true. What'll probably happen to those things is that you'll pass them on to your kids or another family member, and they'll be really glad that you passed it on to them. They'll be excited about that, and they'll find some place for it in their homes, maybe put it in a display cabinet, in a corner someplace, and they'll pass it on to your grandchildren or another family member, and those folks will probably still remember you and would feel guilty getting rid of it. But they'll put it in a box in the basement, and then your great-grandkids or your great-great-grandkids who never knew you will get it, and they'll, you know what they'll do with it? They'll probably auction it on eBay or something, right? I mean, that's what happens to the good stuff, which is part of, I think, what Jesus is getting at with these words that we have from him this morning. The verses we heard from Scripture this morning were words of Jesus from his Sermon on the Mount 2,000 years ago. He stood on this hillside in Galilee talking to peasants in the backcountry of the Roman Empire, and even they needed to hear that wealth and possessions can take an improper place in our lives and in our hearts. And if they needed to hear that, if they needed to hear how material things can preoccupy us and distract us from things that really matter, man, how much do we need those words living in these times and these days? Jesus knows us. He knows the struggles we have. He knows what's in our hearts. He knows we need his help in keeping a proper perspective on the things of our lives. And Jesus sees that sometimes wealth and possessions can do something to your heart that they were never intended to do, that sometimes we don't ourselves even see. He wants to help us gain perspective on earthly possessions so that we have enough detachment from them. He wants us to know and understand in our hearts that those things are temporary, to understand their ultimate fate so that we don't wrap our own fate up with them. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasure in heaven. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And Jesus is addressing this, right? And so in this part of his message, he raises a couple questions for us. He raises questions about how your possessions relate to your relationship with God. And basically, he asks us two questions. He says, where is your treasure? Where is your treasure? And then he asks, who is your master? Let's take just a closer look at those two questions. Now, the first statement that Jesus makes is really quite simple. He says, don't store up treasures on earth. Now, that means we have to ask ourselves, what's a treasure, right? And I would say that a treasure is something we hold dear, something important to us, valuable to us. It's so valuable that you will do what you have to do to protect it or to get it. It shapes your decisions. You make decisions based on how you acquire or hold on to your treasures, right? Now, some treasures aren't things at all. They're people, right? Our families, our children are our treasures. We do just about anything for them, and we make decisions based upon those treasures, right? But there's all sorts of other things that might be a treasure that could could be a little more inappropriate for us to hold that dear, or might even get in the way of us treasuring things that please God. And Jesus gives us this warning. He says, don't devote your lives to the pursuit of these things. They are all temporary. They all end up in the rummage sale in the end. Now, I'm guessing that not many of us here today would actually consciously say that money or wealth is the most important thing in our lives. Nobody tends to say, yes, I worship money, I worship possessions, I think wealth is the most important thing in the world, I'll do whatever it takes to have it, to hold it, to get it. But here's the thing, even if we don't say it or think it, sometimes we act that way, and we do make a lot of decisions based on money. What job will I have? Where will I live? What car will I drive? How much is gasoline today? How is the stock market doing? When can I retire? It impacts the daily decisions of our lives, our long-term living conditions, who our neighbors will be, who will vote for, all kinds of things. We make some pretty important decisions, sometimes based primarily on our pocketbooks, right? For most of us, it's a guiding principle for how we live, and it's a pretty important one. And it's important for us to consider and realize that we do that. We make decisions based on money, and that's okay. But here's the question Jesus is asking us. Is it the guiding principle in your life? When it comes down to what is most important to you, what guides those decisions, where is your treasure? And then he asks, who is your master? He doesn't put it that way, but what he basically says is you might not realize it, but you might have two masters. He talks about how you might serve God or you might serve money. And Jesus says it could be either of those, but you can't serve both with all your heart. Now, the idea of having a master had a much more immediate connection in Jesus' day. They still had slavery back then. People would sometimes sell themselves into slavery for economic reasons, to get out of debt. They might be taken into captivity during a battle, become slaves that way. And people understood that when you were a slave, your master owned you. They gave you orders. That master determined your destiny, and you did his or her bidding. Now, I understand pretty well what it might mean to have God as my master, what it means to be God's servant. I understand, and I want that, right? I want to follow God. I want to live for God and be inside God's love and God's will in this world. For me, that's part of what it means to be a Christian. You wake up every morning and you say, God, I'm yours. What do you want from me today? How can I honor you? How can I live for you? That's something I understand, right? What's harder sometimes to understand is how we can make possessions our master. I mean, what does that look like? I paid for those things. I own them. How can I possibly be their slave? And that is a little harder to understand until we take some time to think about how that works. And the thing I've come to realize about money is that, well, spending money can be addictive, can't it? It's fun, it's easy to do, especially if you have credit cards. It's easy to get on a roll and keep going and buying things that you want, things that you like. It feels good, and it can be almost like a drug for us, for some people. If we get sad or depressed, we like to go out and buy something that we want that might make us feel better, at least for a little while. And there's so many great things for us to spend our money on, right? There's these awesome cell phones and iPads and gourmet coffee and super high definition TVs and streaming services. And as we get used to spending and acquiring these things, we realize that money slips through our fingers pretty fast sometimes. And when we get old enough to have credit cards, it's even easier to spend money because then it doesn't even seem like we're spending that much money. So we go and we buy more things. We don't feel like cooking, so we go out for dinner. Don't just do that once in a blue moon. We do that over and over and over again. We have our adjustable rate mortgages on our homes, loans on our cars, and we use credit to get things we can't really quite afford yet, but over time we figure we'll get it paid off. You know that routine, right? And finally you get to a place and you realize, well, you've become a slave to your stuff. Because once you have it, you have to pay for it and maintain what you have, and all that stuff is going to end up in somebody's garage sale someday. And now we're sitting here today, and it's time to think about, what does God want me to do? But you don't have the money to buy a Thanksgiving meal for somebody else, or the money to go on a mission trip, let alone the freedom to take a few days off work because you need to earn the extra money that you need to pay off your mortgage and your credit card bills and your car loan. And you see people who are hurting, families that need help, ways your church needs your time and talents to spread God's love in this world, but you have no money and no time to help because you're up to here in financial obligations. Maybe that describes you. Maybe not so much, but when the preacher starts to talk about money and giving your first and your best to God, and you get uncomfortable or upset because you have no space to give, and you know where God is trying to lead you, but you just can't do it. You can't do it. When you get to that place, well, you've already become a slave to your money, to your stuff, and not to God. When you can't follow God because of your lifestyle and your financial obligations, you've become a slave to money. And Jesus says no one can truly serve two masters. You will either love the one and hate the other, or be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Who is your master? And the question then is, how do we overcome this? How do we overcome that material urge? Jesus says, don't store up treasure on earth where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. And just like everything else he talks about in his sermon, when Jesus is talking about money and storing up treasure in heaven and all these things, he's really talking about our hearts. Setting our hearts on God and the things of God, and doing what it takes to detach ourselves from the things that detract from that, separating ourselves from things that keep us from giving ourselves completely to God. Later in this gospel, Matthew tells a story about a rich young man that comes to Jesus and says, Jesus, I want to do God's will more than anything else in my life. And Jesus says, that's great. Keep the commandments. And the man says, well, I already do that. What else do I need to do, Jesus? And Jesus gives him this piece of advice. He doesn't give it to anybody else in his stories. This is not necessarily a universal principle. It's just that Jesus looks into this man's heart. And he sees that if he wants to be perfect, he needs to detach himself from his stuff. He's attached to it, and it controls him. And so he says, if you would be perfect, not if you want to get into heaven, but if you would be perfect, get rid of all your stuff. Sell everything you have. And then take the money you get from that and give it to the poor. Then come follow me. Now that's a pretty radical prescription for a person who's been enslaved to his money. I hope Jesus doesn't tell all of us to do exactly that, that we could become detached without taking that radical a step, but he is saying that this is how important it is. It is important for us to take steps to place our focus, our priorities on the things that matter, the things that last, the things God cares about. We need to focus on storing our treasures up in heaven. You are meant to serve God. Your money is meant to serve you and to enable you to serve God in the ways God calls you to. Biblically speaking, that happens in a few ways. One of the first ones that usually comes to mind for people is tithing, right? The Bible teaches us that we give the first 10% of our income to God. Now, I know for some of you, 10% is asking way too much. But the basic principle behind tithing is that we're supposed to set aside a portion of our income for God. And that doesn't mean that we get to the end of the month and figure out how much is left over for God. It means we set something aside as a priority for our resources. That's what tithing is about. I've been tithing for 20 years now, and I can tell you it's not a burden. It's a blessing. It's so liberating to release your money into God's hands. It's not always easy. But man, when I give that first portion of my best portion to God faithfully, I enjoy the other 90% so much more. Of all the spiritual disciplines I have, tithing helps me keep my head on straight and keeps my other priorities all in line with God's priorities. Second part, we need to learn to live below our means rather than above them. We live in a culture that teaches us and pressures us to live above our means, to buy things that it says will make us happy, will make us fit in. Jesus invites us to live below our means. Many people, maybe some of you, live just above what we can really afford. I mean, what if you stepped your financial obligations back just a few steps, chose a more modest car or home, a smaller cell phone plan, fewer channels on your TV, whatever it takes, and do it because God has things that God wants you to do, and you can't do them at your present lifestyle. And here's the thing. If you do that, think of all the things you could do to bless people around you and do God's work. Think of it. God needs your time, your money to accomplish something great. What will you let God accomplish in you? Third, keep in mind where all that stuff that you buy is going to end up. Because it's all going to end up in somebody's rummage sale, right? Ask yourself, do I really need this? And will I be able to serve God to the best of my ability if I have it? Hold all your stuff with that kind of detachment so you realize everything you have is just stuff. And it's only valuable insofar as it serves your purposes in carrying out God's will in your life. And if it gets in the way, then get rid of it. Finally, on a daily basis, yield your life to God. Let God be in charge of your life. When you wake up in the morning, pray, Lord, I give my life to you. I give this day to you. How can I honor you? How can I follow you? Pray that every morning, and you will find yourself storing up treasures in heaven. I'll end with this. Our society tells us that we should earn all we can and spend all we can so that we can have all we can. John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, had a different picture of the good life. He said, earn all you can. As long as you're doing it fairly and honestly and justly, make all the money you possibly can. And then he said, save it. Save all you can. Pinch every penny, scrimp, and save and make your dollar stretch as far as you possibly can. Why? So you can give all you possibly can. So that you can bless the world through your gifts. Give your money to the kingdom of God. Use that money to build up treasure in heaven and build God's kingdom. Give your money and time and things to the things that God calls you to do to make a difference and accomplish God's purposes in this world. Imagine if we did that. We could live, I think, what we'll find is a life that brings joy. We'll know that our hearts are in the right place, our vision is good, we're serving God as our Master and Lord, and our treasure will truly be in heaven. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we give you thanks and praise for your grace and mercy in our lives. We need it. You know that we get caught up in the things of this world. We find it so appealing, and our eyes are focused on the latest wonderful thing, the next best thing to make our lives easier. And we know that you give us all these things so we can enjoy them, so long as they don't become our masters, so long as we are pursuing your love, your ways first in our lives, and not just giving you our leftovers. Lord, help us remember that every cool gadget we have to have, everything we buy this year will all end up in a rummage sale someday. We pray that you would forgive us when we forget these things, that you would purify our hearts. Give us a vision for living our lives in such a way that we're generous, rich in good works, compassionate towards those in need, and faithful in bringing our tithes and offerings to you. Help us, Lord, in this, so that we might please you and serve the neighbors around us. In Jesus' name.
Lord, you have come to the lake shore.
We're so glad that you joined us for worship this morning on YouTube. We hope that some part of this message today was a help and a blessing to you and gave you something to think about and to live with for this coming week. At this time, you're invited to join us by Zoom in order to continue our time of worship this morning with prayer, with sharing of joys and concerns, and a time of fellowship together. Thank you. God bless.